Of all flavors, we give you thanks for this time to come together, to learn from one another, to gain some wisdom and knowledge, and to spend some time together. We ask you, Lord, to bless this time, and to bless our conversation, and to guide us safely home and out to be your feet and hands and heart in this world. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Well, welcome everyone. My name is Dan McLean. I'm the chaplain, the Episcopal chaplain to William and Mary, and Bruton is my home. And Ed has asked if I would introduce tonight's panelists before I guess handing it over to you all. Yes? Okay. All right. That sounded, that was a confident okay. So I've already introduced myself. To my left is Father James Glass, Roman Catholic chaplain to William and Mary. Next to him is Andy Valentine, the pastor of St. Stephen's Lutheran Church and Lutheran chaplain to William and Mary. And to his left is Ben Robertson, the RUF chaplain, Reformed University Fellowship, and your Presbyterian, right? Presbyterian chaplain, one of the Presbyterian chaplains to the College of William and Mary. Speaking for my friends here, we're all glad to be here tonight to talk about the Reformation and its legacy.
Good evening. My name is Alexander Angeloff, and I teach at the College of Lord and Mary, Courses on Christianity at the Department of Religious Studies.
My name is Jim Cobb. I'm a retired Lutheran pastor. It's called the Luther thing, and at Christopher Wren, and a few semesters, and some origin development of Christian worship in this last semester. And it's been wonderful to be invited to make presentations. I did Luther and Calvin 2 weeks. Alex did the English Reformation, and tonight we're here with the panel to see what are the derivatives of some of the history and some of the themes in theology. And I think what we want to do is just start with some opening remarks by each of the panelists, and eventually we're going to get to the questions that you all carry with you. So, Dan,
I'm starting a little. All right, so I've been asked to talk a little bit about the Anglican tradition. As we heard last week, the Anglican tradition had auspicious beginnings, and so I won't comment on its beginnings as much as to try and sketch some of the contours of that tradition today. In about 5 minutes, it's impossible to do that job. In time, space, the Anglican tradition spans continents, centuries, and media, some of which we're going to look at this evening. But instead of throwing up my hands in despair and running, I'll instead maybe try to highlight a couple markers that I think can be helpful to you all to keep in mind when thinking about Anglicans and, here in the United States, Episcopalians. These markers help us to see, I think, how Anglicanism resisted what our forebears perceived to be extremes. So the first, in the 16th century, the Church of England became separate from the Church of Rome. We heard that last week. And in this respect, Anglicans were attempting to resist a sense of absolute episcopal power over the universal church. And I think that's a kind of a clear outcome. Second, in the following century, the 17th century, Anglicanism was pretty clearly distinguished from Puritanism in its reaction to first the coup against the monarchy in 1649, and then not reaction, but doubling down by restoring the monarchy in 1660, and then tripling down in 1662 by issuing a brand new prayer book. Third, in the 18th century, as evangelicalism, which in the 18th century is a little bit different than what we call evangelicalism today, but as evangelicalism in the 18th century came to rely more and more heavily on experience and feeling as authoritative in religious life, Anglicans, by contrast, maintained a strong role for reason and emphasized the relationship of reason and the spiritual life. So they're attempting to integrate. So in these three historical markers, we see, as one historical scholar put it, Ellen Cherry, Anglicanism is trying to steer a course to sustain the Catholic faith by avoiding extremes of papal authoritarianism, biblicism, and experientialism and conversionism. One final thing to point out is that Anglican theology is concerned first and foremost with worship, especially in the case of the first century of the Anglican tradition. Our theologians were quick to see the relationship of theology to practice, and they engaged in theological discourse, and I think we still do this today, with an eye towards the ramifications for worship. And that practical observation helps me segue into what I think is the most distinctive aspect of Anglican theology and practice. We can see in Anglican theology, preaching, and above all, our arts, a concern for the breadth of human experience, with human practices and passions, the experiences of the head and the heart, the prayers of the mouth, and the work of our hands, the mundane and the transcendent. And it's important, I think, to recognize that this preoccupation has not been merely academic, but also pastoral and aesthetic. Anglicans have sought to unite these disparate and liminal experiences as part of bringing all things into subjection under Christ. So I recognize I'm kind of going on here, and so I'm going to skip ahead to the end. I've given you all a handout of poems by two Anglican poets who also happened to also be priests. First, the rogue John Donne,
who had a very exciting beginning of his life and an even more exciting end of his life as the dean of St. Paul's Cathedral in London. And in his preaching, we see that Dunn is a pretty staunch proponent of the Reformation. But in his life, Dunn is the descendant of Catholics who have strong Jesuit ties. And we see in his poetry a much more nuanced integration of the faith, I think. And on the other side of your page, you have two poems by the divine George Herbert, who was a Cambridge scholar. Now, Cambridge was a hotbed of Protestantism and was the sort of academic and oratory headquarters of King James's Protestant reforms. King James called George Herbert the jewel of Cambridge, and Herbert was on his way to a flourishing political career both in Cambridge and in London before deciding rather abruptly to become a priest, and then moved to a very small town and undertook what some people see as a rather experimental approach to parish ministry. What I'm hoping you'll see in these poets, sadly we don't have time to read these poems line by line and do a close reading. If you were my students, that's what we'd spend the rest of the period doing. But I'm hoping that you'll read these and enjoy them and be edified by them. What I'd like you to see in them is both Dunn and Herbert are attempting to quick to say, well, we're not saying we cannot use
this about how our most recent sort of the message of, you know, character first, etc. I don't want to step on any toes or whatever, but just saying like, hey, you know, I was raised on this one thing, and then now suddenly we're getting endorsements from all sorts of evangelical leaders in sort of an unqualified way. That has been very jarring to the younger generation. I'm almost 40 years old and for rich everyone below. So, whoa, that's not what we grew up hearing. And so the Q conference that we're doing, and as well as several other things, are trying to take a different sort of approach. One, to address sort of the cultural, epistemological differences that Christians and a secular world would have with one another. And engage some of these large questions of life, and the theme is hospitality for our conference. But one of the ways I think is most obvious, and the quote I was mentioning before is, you know, one of the speakers says, you know, I spend so much of my life avoiding the very people that Jesus spent his life pursuing. And I think that was a sort of take your breath in moment watching that. And I just think that to, in unity, love our neighbors and find ways to do that well, I just think is a very good place to start. I don't think it's the only thing, but I do think we definitely, the world needs that, and we need it, so.
That might be what our parents are about, too.
Yeah. I have a question over here. Okay, just a moment.
All right, so this is kind of two half questions, I guess. So please forgive me. But what do you guys think, from your different respective traditions, that we can learn from the Reformation or even the Counter-Reformation about these modern ecumenical problems, these church-dividing issues, or even unifying issues, and in what ways can we be critical of the Reformation or the Counter-Reformation with respect to these ecumenical dialogues?
Start with the other end.
Oh, I have to go first?
Yeah.
I like saying just what Andy says. So I mentioned, you know, Potter, from my the nomination, I think that there's a critical side of the notion of splitting, and maybe splitting too easily, right? While at the same time acknowledging that there are real differences, as Father Glass was saying, you know, that those differences are significant, and we shouldn't just pretend that they're not there. I think that modern notions of unity are like, let's all pretend that we agree with one another, and that's just not going to work. That's just creating a third belief system that neither of us believe, and then we all agree to believe the same thing. So how can we be critical of the Reformation? I think, in part, though, I would say my understanding of sort of the main reformers, I think, you know, Luther and Calvin in particular, I don't think it was their vision. It wasn't their idea to start something new. They would have argued that they were trying to return to what the church was and to continue it. And interesting that, you know, with respect to baptism and other things, you know, that there wasn't this movement to rebaptize once they had come up with these, you know, different theological insights. They were still accepting their own baptisms and the baptism of other people. And so I think that was ultimately the goal. But in the meantime, I guess, in terms of going forward, I think allowing each other to have those differences and to do that well, to have robust discussion and even debate over those things, but to also then say, what are ways that we still continue to love one another and work together for the sake of Christ and his world? So
I think that my critique of the Reformation is that too many theologians were requiring too much agreement. And so I think there's a great promise in the path forward with this idea of what is church dividing and what is not. Maybe we can make progress on that.
I think the Catholic Church, personally, the importance of Scripture, I think one thing that the Catholic Church learned historically and even recently from the Reformation is the critical importance of God's Word, of Scripture, in formation, in understanding our faith. And there's been a resurgence since Vatican II in Scripture study, which is really helping to revitalize the Catholic Church and help it understand itself. You know, you can't understand the liturgy of the Mass, for example, without really understanding Scripture and the Old Testament in particular, and Jewish culture as well, which is the Old Testament. I think, however, that without some acknowledgement, without coming to a solution to the problem of authority outside of Scripture, who's going to interpret it? How are we going to come to a consensus on which doctrines are essential and which are non-divisive?
Right.
Until that problem is solved, I see a spiritual unity, a sort of an ephemeral unity, a spiritual unity, but not the concrete unity that exists, that we see. Even within the Catholic Church, there are all kinds of disunity and opinions and arguments over what individual Catholics believe, but there is a structure there that at least makes the possibility of unity. I think of the papacy as the necessary condition for the possibility of ecclesial unity in the real world, in the concrete world. And I understand this.
It's a great question, Potter. And I'm sitting here, and I had all this time to think about an answer, and I'm still struggling with one. So I know how Ben feels now. What they all said. So I don't know that I necessarily have anything poignant enough to say about the Reformation that's worth saying now, and it'd be half-formed anyways. But I will say that one of the things I've appreciated in conversations about the Reformation over the last 10-15 years have been the kind of humble moments where different denominations have come together in conversation. One of the ones that's most striking to me and that I often go back to in my own thinking is John Paul II saying and I think it was dialogue with the Orthodox or the Lutherans, that maybe what Catholics need to start by doing is formulating the authority of the Bishop of Rome as a primacy of service. And then what if we started from that perspective? So it's not giving up on the primacy of the Roman Episcopacy, but it's starting to think about that primacy in more maybe gospel-oriented ways. Jesus says, you know, if you would be first, you would be last. And, you know, we just had the great reading in our lectionary of the Sons of Zebedee, just like last week or the week before. And so it took somebody like John Paul II to really begin pressing on that and thinking about that. And that's fostered all sorts of new trends, new attitudes, and even new lines of theological inquiry in ecumenical dialogue. So it's been really exciting to me to see Catholics run with some of the themes of the Protestant Reformation, incorporate them into their own thinking. And I would just reiterate what James says. There's all sorts of diversity in denominations that talking about the Reformation can often obscure. You know, we don't see often the diversity in our own traditions when we're talking to somebody else from another tradition, especially when we're vehemently defending the authority or the integrity of our tradition. And it's easy sometimes also, I've been having some conversations with other Canterburians lately, where it's easy to miss out on how diverse and maybe even troubled the waters are in our friends' denominations. And so I guess if I do have a criticism of the Reformation or the legacy of the Reformation, it makes these other traditions opaque to us in ways that hurt our own thinking about our own denominations, but also hurt our ability to sympathize and have compassion with friends in other denominations.
Alex, would you speak?
Sure. Just a comment to that. Yeah. I think what I could sort of extract as a lesson from the Reformation, both as a historian and also kind of as a reflecting from the perspective of theology, is this question, very important in the time of the Reformation, and especially today, I think, the basic question of Christian identity. And what is the unique voice or even agency of Christianity, regardless of differences, theological, cultural, after the Reformation, denominational differences? What does Christianity as a community, Christianity as spirituality, individuality, contribute that's unique and good for the problems of each cultural or historical moment? And I think the Reformation, in its kind of purest essence, was a reflection on that. We Christians have the mandate to be, back to the biblical source, the light of the world. And how do we shine upon this world? And then politics came up, and as our commentators, I think, aptly, astutely observed, divisions happened, and they appear to be irreparable divisions. And scholars, especially secular scholars, talk about a post-Christian era, that the new millennium in which we live is a post-Christian millennium. Not so sure. I think actually our panel today gives me, as a relatively young person, some hope that maybe in the clouds of postmodernity of today, it appears as though we have a crisis of Christian identity, but there are so many commonalities in the fact that they can sit together on one table and joke and laugh in good spirit is a hope that we are in another stage of that Reformation, and perhaps the future will give us even clearer sense of this Christian identity, and above all, the voice, the unique voice that Christianity has, and the real solutions that it can offer to major issues such as politics, culture, and above all, who we are as human beings and what our duties are. So that's my response to Pi.
Yes.
First of all, I'd like to thank the Murphys for asking us to come here. We're members of the Byzantine Catholic Church on Palace Lane. And The other thing I would really thank people is talk about humility, because I would think that God is probably smiling at all of us right now, trying to us to figure out what he's like. and to that point, my wife's uncle was a Ukrainian Catholic priest. He's deceased. He's the first one to tell me about the filioque, which to explain that, first of all, there are 23, I think, Father Alex, let's say 23 Catholic churches. They all recognize the Pope, but there's the Melkites and the Maronites and the Byzantines and the Ukrainians, et cetera, Alexandrians. Filioque, okay, is the comment that may have split, I don't know, you probably weren't an expert, of the Orthodox from the Catholics, okay, because the original creed was saying that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, proceeded from the Father, and that was added later another council from the Father and the Son. And the interesting thing is, if you go to a Latin Rite church at St. Bede's, or you go down to the college, you will say the creed, and I don't know what you do in the Episcopal Church, but it says from the Father and the Son. But if you go to the Byzantine Catholic Church, it says from the Father and doesn't mention the Son. And that's in the same Catholic Church, basically. And I suppose it means that we say it's from the Father. Doesn't mean it's not from the Son, but we don't mention it. So the whole thing, I think, goes to humility and shows that we're so mixed up that even the Catholic Church, we have two different creeds, but probably means the same thing.
Would you like to comment?
When you go through an American education and end up in school with studying Western civilization, you get into that 15th century, and all of a sudden, the Catholic Church in Western Europe started fractionalizing, primarily in Germany and then in England. Didn't happen so much in France. And I remember the big discussion, almost 2 weeks of spring of my freshman year in college, debating why. Was it economic? Was it theological? Was it philosophical? Was it political? What do you lay what started the Reformation? Why did we all abandon the one true church that was common in the 14th and early 15th century?
I could start with that.
The theological issue was the selling of indulgences. So on October 31st, 1517, Luther issued the 95 Theses. It was directed at that issue. And there are subtleties with all of that. But that was the theological issue. I think what exacerbated the situation was Luther was so hard to get along with, and the Pope at the time was so hard to get along with it. So I think about when Francis started criticizing the Catholic Church. Francis was much more radical than Luther. But in that era, there was enough, there was the ability to widen the umbrella and include Francis, who became the Franciscans, under the umbrella of Catholicism. In the 16th century, though, there was just such rigidity, insisting on all 15 agreements for the Reformed and the Lutheran to stay together. 14 out of 15 isn't enough. I think that was a real factor.
You know, Christians have been fighting with each other since the apostles. Since the apostles. I mean, I'm going to go all the way home. They were fighting with Jesus. What do you mean you're going to die? So it's in our genes and or slacks. And you know, I coming last week, you know, one of the thoughts I had in your presentation was, you know, we think about the Reformation as this sort of world dividing issue,
But India, what, the 10th or the 11th century, as Venetian raiders were sacking Constantinople, and the Pope wasn't rushing to the Patriarch of Constantinople's aid as quickly as the Patriarch thought that he should. That was the world-dividing issue. You know, that was the East being ripped from the West. And the Filioque was part of that, but, you know, Venetian raiders tearing your city apart, that's, and people are dying. You know, that at that point, I don't think the Filioque was on their mind. And it becomes a kind of, at times, it becomes a kind of convenient scapegoat. But, you know, I think the biggest problem, Christians start killing each other. And that's where our witness falls apart. That's where our testimony to each other falls apart. You know, you talk about humility. Pride is lethal. And the Reformation, just as a side comment, didn't really take off in France because the French were very good at killing off their reformers. And that's why Calvin ends up in Geneva.
One of the phrases that comes out of the Reformation is semper reformandi, meaning the church is always reforming. Well, in the spirit of that, the current thing is still to say that when you look at the church, it is always reforming. There is never a time when it comes into some kind of static existence. It is dynamic. It is a spirit-led assembly of the baptized, and you never know what surprises God has in store to spin the world and spin the church in a direction where we do not know it's going. It is not static. It is dynamic. It is not structured to simply exist as a monolith. It is a spirit-led, where are we going to be surprised next? Semper reformandi. That's what came out of the Reformation. And I think where are we going next is what this panel, I think, is really about. Now, you know, in answer to that, the church had theological reasons for what happened. It had economic reasons for what happened because money was going out of Germany. And people in Germany wanted to stay where it was. It was political because Germany was governed by princes who had the elector of the Holy Roman Emperor. And that became a divide with Charles V trying to unify the princes in order to fight the Turks. So you get back to kind of a war mentality. But this dynamic, spirit-led movement of the church addressing new issues in a new culture is both attractive and frightening. So it is almost back to that sense of which side do we really come down on? Are we motivated by fear to simply preserve what has been, or are we motivated by hope for what will be? And if you hear those two words in politics, no wonder, because that's a great divide. Yeah.
Can I make a comment?
Yep.
Can I throw it?
Too many people to injure.
I remember having a conversation with my friend maybe about a year ago, and we were trying to talk about what Christians are, you know, what differentiates Christians, and we both, I said to him, I said, you know, we're really a people of hope, because we're a people of the resurrection. And what I started hearing, and Jim, you really went to it, is we are a people of hope, and yeah, we can talk about our differences, but implicit in everything we do as Christians is having this trust in the Spirit that Christ breathed upon the apostles and through them us as we continue with this dialogue going forward. So I just had to add my two cents on that one. Sorry,
yeah,
that's
great.
I have a very simple question. I think I really appreciated your comments on hope as opposed to fear. And I was very impressed by what Pope Francis did, and I'm not going to have the proper terms, but was it an encyclical on the environment where we were not arguing about how it has happened, but we were more concerned about what do we do now? And I think of the churches are missing, the young people want something relevant. They want something that, and I think they need some, I just, Father Blaise, would you talk more about that in the cyclical?
Hey.
His second or third encyclical, Laudato Si, which comes from St. Francis's poetry, praise him is basically what it means. All creeds, I think the first phrase of that hymn is Laudate Si. Anyway, so yeah, I think he wanted to do exactly that. He realized that in the world scene, one of the big concerns of young people and old people alike is the environmental crisis, pollution, as well as, you know, water quality, and global warming plays into that as well. And so he decided to address that issue as the Pope. Catholic Church has always had things to say about the environment, but this is the first time it was ever said at that level of an encyclical and a whole document dedicated just to the environment. So I recommend you take a look at it. It came out at least two years ago. It's been out a while, 2 or 3 years. It's online. You can look it up on your computer. You can read it. One of the things that struck me in that encyclical was how he tied, though, the problems that we're facing in the environment with the problems we're facing socially in our culture. That until we fix the relationship between us, between men and women, between nation states, until we fix the problems of how we treat each other and how we treat the poor and how we live, we're not going to be able to solve the problems of the environment. They're not isolated from our entire culture of how we think and how we live. And so, anyway, read it. Laudato Si.
One of the things I like about Laudato Si so much is his concept of integral development. And when he talks about integral development, he's contrasting that with the really invasive developmental projects that Latin America has seen. And so beginning to think about economic and infrastructure development, especially in places like Latin America and Africa, as being informed by some of the most core principles that the Catholic Church has about what makes somebody human. So I would also recommend it. Yeah.
Yes, time. One more.
Thank you.
I don't think there are too many in here who were teenagers during the 50s, the early 50s. I was at William & Mary. And religion wasn't the most important thing in my life, my freshman year, sophomore year, or my junior year for that But we liked a good time, we liked a party, but there was an event going on in Richmond, and it was a Billy Graham crusade. Anyone go to any crusades in here? Okay. We decided we wanted to go. I mean, that's what everybody was talking about. And this was a disparate group. As I said, we liked the party. But anyway, we took a carload. We went up there. And what an experience it was. And it didn't make any difference. We had a Catholic in the car. We had a couple of wannabe Baptists. And I'm not sure what the others were. But nonetheless, everybody came away from that with a sense of there really is some energy here. There's something going on. And there's a good message. It's a message. It's a good news message. And we need something like that, I think, because look at the statistics today at how the number of people going to church is dramatically dropping. And we need something that's going to energize them and not to emphasize the differences. And one of the stories Billy Graham told there that I it stuck in my mind, and he said he was describing a service that was going on in this church, and it was more of a conservative type church. And this one congregant kept saying, "Amen," or "Hallelujah," interrupting him. And finally, one of the ushers went by and reached over and told her, said, "Ma'am, you just got to calm down. You just got to stay quiet." She says, "I can't help it. I just got religion." She said, "You didn't get it here."
Thank you.
Somebody told me that there was on a recent TV show series, somebody said to a spouse, to like the husband, said, "Armin, didn't you just love the joy that was in our Lutheran church this Sunday?" And he said, "We Lutherans, we don't do joy.
Right.
We do quiet contentment." My favorite Billy Graham thing, he said there was one thing he'd never seen in his life, one thing, and that was a hearse pulling a U-Haul. Which is a great stewardship illustration. And you want us to go? Keep rolling. Okay, one more back here.
Yep.
Okay. Being an old Philadelphian, and I can remember the words of Ben Franklin, we better all hang together, or we're going to hang separately. Now, the question hasn't come up, and I haven't been to the other sessions, but is Christianity being threatened by Islam? You hear of all these Christians being murdered, perhaps in Europe. Is this a concern of your denomination?
Alex, can you address? You've got some.
I think yes, it is at all, not just Christianity, but Islam. There's a certain strain of Islamic thought, and that is certainly what's the word?
Militant.
And so, is it a threat? Yeah, well, I don't think we see it much here, but, and I don't know much about what's going on the other side of the world. I just know that there have been a tremendous number of not only Christians, but Muslims persecuting other Muslims who don't agree with them as well in the Middle East. So there's it doesn't seem to be something that is in the news at this moment. That being said, we as Christians, we cannot fight fire with fire. We cannot overcome evil with evil. We must love our enemies and we must pray for them. And so we must constantly seek peace so far as it depends on us.
I think in the ELCA, there is a director of ecumenical and interfaith relations. And so the ELCA stance would be very open to where can we find common ground with non-Christian faith traditions. My experience has been that those who are claiming to be Muslim, who are killing Christians and other Muslims, are violating a fundamental tenet of Islam. And rather than Islam threatening Christianity, I think there's some good and healthy competition that's coming from Islam. In the prisons, for instance, there are many converts to Islam because of the requirement for frequent daily prayer, discipline in the faith. And so prisoners who never really picked up on any daily discipline from their Christian upbringing are attracted to that in Islam. Well, Dan was talking about how the Book of Common Prayer is Benedictine. That's true of our Lutheran book as well, which means there would be morning prayer, noontime prayer, evening prayer, compline, and even mid-morning prayer, mid-afternoon prayer, that's provided for as well.
Brunch.
Perhaps, yeah, brunch prayer, right. Perhaps we Christians could look at the discipline that Islam teaches and say, we can learn something from that. Perhaps that would increase the daily fervor of Christians.
I have to invoke. You want to say something?
I guess it's that requires more than just one class, an entire course. But basically, the kind of
history of Islam and Christianity interacting over the ages obviously is very long and complicated, but it's not, you may be surprised, a history of conflict necessarily for the majority of it. So that's the first thing that I would say. And also the second thing is there are many, many Muslim theologians around the world, including in the United States, that themselves are critical of the violent streak of Islam in the past as well as in the present. So you shouldn't put Islam in a single category, just like you can't basically put all Christians under the same criteria of judgment. And I think that, again, in the spirit of a new reformation, of a new millennium, the spirit of ecumenicity should extend to other religious traditions. And one of them could be secularism or atheism, skepticism. We should come together and basically have a conversation about the true, the beautiful, and the good. That's what it's all about, ultimately.
Thanks, Alex. And we want to appreciate all that you've arranged through these weeks.
Hang on.
Yeah, I just want to thank everyone here. I know that a lot of people want to ask a lot of questions, and I know I'm the bad guy because I'm the timekeeper, okay? And I've really gone over, all right? But I'm sure that the panelists will remain here, and if you have a specific question you want to talk, ask one of them or make a comment to one of them, they'll make the time available. Again, thank you, folks.